welcome, and thank you for joining us as we look back at some highlights from the Adam Sweeting Lecture Series, in which experts, innovators, and scientists deliver fascinating talks on pioneering developments in their area of expertise. The series began with The Light Fantastic, the inaugural Alf Adams lecture in 2012. A number of inspiring lectures have followed, drawing an audience of curious students, alumni, STEM colleagues, the general public, and notable guests of honour, including our Chancellor, His Royal Highness the Duke of Kent. The Adam Sweeting Lecture Series was created in honour of two of the University of Surrey's most prestigious academics. Distinguished Professor of Physics, Alf Adams, who invented the strained layer quantum well laser, and Distinguished Professor of Space Engineering, Sir Martin Sweeting, renowned worldwide as a pioneer of modern small satellites. To celebrate previous lectures that have taken place and in anticipation for those to come, we have chosen some highlights which we hope will feed your intrigue and remind you of the importance and captivation of frontier science and technology.
I joined the University of Surrey in 1967, just as it started to move from Battersea to its new campus here in Guildford. When I retired in 2003, the then Vice Chancellor, Sir Christopher Snowden, suggested we start a public lecture series called the Alf Adams Lectures. These would be held annually and were a considerable success. So when our present Vice-Chancellor, Max Liu, joined the university, he suggested that we have two lectures a year and also welcome aboard the second Fellow of the Royal Society, Sir Martin Sweeting. These lectures have been both entertaining and informative. I remember when Sir Martin Rees was asked by his host at such an occasion whether, as Astronomer Royal, it was his duty to prepare a horoscope for the Queen. I feel very honoured to be associated with these lectures, and I hope that they can recommence again soon.
In 2012, the Alf Adams series was established, with the inaugural lecture, The Light Fantastic, taking place at the Royal Society.
That story reminds me and brings home to me the enormous strides that the university has made since then, and how it's developed into such an excellent institution today. And I have had lots of pleasure and privilege to actually take part in that.
Well, the Adam Sweeting Lecture series was the brainchild of the Vice-Chancellor, and I think it was a fantastic idea, because the whole purpose of the series is to bring in erudite and well-known speakers to broaden our mind, give us some detail in their scientific and sociological expertise. And this really is an opportunity for staff and students and the local community to come and learn something about what is going on in the university, and also our contribution to understanding science and our place in the universe. Perhaps my favourite memory of all of that was from the talk by Lord Rees, who's the Astronomer Royal, who, of course, being a spaceman myself, we were very interested to hear on his views on space and science and its role in contributing our understanding of the universe.
In 2017, the series became known as the Adam Sweeting Lecture, and Professor Lord Martin Rees presented an intriguing insight into surviving the century, hopes and threats from new technologies.
Well, it's a great privilege to be here, and I'd like to start with a cosmic cameo. We've had this iconic image for about 50 years, But suppose aliens existed, and that some have been watching our planet for its entire 45 million centuries. What would they have seen? Over nearly all of that time, Earth's appearance would have changed very gradually. Continents drifted, ice cover waxed and waned, successive species emerged, evolved and became extinct. Our increasingly interconnected world depends on elaborate networks, electric power grids, air traffic control, international finance, globally dispersed manufacturing, and so forth. But unless these networks are highly resilient, their benefits could be outweighed by catastrophic, albeit rare, breakdowns. Our cities would be paralyzed without electricity. Air travel can spread a pandemic worldwide within days. And social media can spread panic and rumor and economic contagion literally at the speed of light. My theme has been that even in the concertina timeline that astronomers envisage, extending billions of years into the future as well as into the past, this century may be a defining era. It could be the first when humans jumpstart the transition to electronic and potentially immortal entities, which eventually spread their influence far beyond the Earth and far transcend our limitations. Or, to take a darker view, it could be the century when our follies could foreclose that immense future potential.
In the first of a double header in 2019, we welcomed Dame Jocelyn Bell Burnell, who presented A Celebration of Women in Astronomy.
We do need more scientists and engineers in the country, and we're failing to make full use of all our talent. It's been established that, in spite of common perception, girls can do physics brilliantly, particularly if they're in an all-girls group. And my global data, I would suggest, shows that it's culture, not women's brains, that's the limiting issue. Individuals can be completely fair, but the place they work can be sexist because of its institutional practices or structures. And that's one of the things we're trying to understand and sort out these days. For instance, there could be biases in recruitment or in retention. Unconscious bias is one of the things that we're learning about. There could be a lack of understanding that a different management style from yours is perfectly okay, that there are different management styles, for instance.
For the second instalment in 2019, Sir Paul Nurse gave an insight into Science as Revolution, celebrating science and its enduring power to change the way we live.
Something we forget, only 100 years ago, or just a little more than that, even in highly developed countries such as the UK, life expectancy was around 50 years. It is now around 85 years. That 50 years was probably only 15 years greater than the agricultural revolution, 10,000 years before. We have put on another 35 years of our lifespan in the last 100 years, and that is all due to knowledge produced by science and sometimes simple technologies like decent sanitation. But it is all based on knowledge. I finish with a comment about how we can continue to keep science helping the human condition. I think a critical factor is we need to have a healthy relationship between science and society. We need to ensure science is used for public good and not for the reverse. We need to make good decisions about the use of the knowledge, which is based on science but depends on societies with the right values, underpinned by healthy and effective democracies, in my view. For science to play its proper role requires a public at ease with science and a democracy that can cope with the complex decisions that involve science. I'm an optimist, and I'm optimistic that in the future society will understand that and see the value of science, which will bring continual revolutionary changes, not only to our knowledge, but to improve society and our human condition. I conclude, science is truly the most long-lasting revolutionary activity known to humankind and will continue to bring great benefits to us all. Thank you very much.